like to welcome everybody tonight to the College of Complexes. My name is Tim, as most of you already know. The College of Complexes is at Depper's East Restaurant on Addison Avenue in Chicago. We meet every Saturday at 8 o'clock for...
6.
You're right, 6 o'clock. Still thinking about the Lincoln Restaurant.
Yeah.
Our college consists of the following format, where we have announcements, our speaker speaks, then we have a question and answer period, followed by our infamous rebuttal period. If anybody has announcements, please come forward at this time, and I'll make the first one, is that these proceedings will be recorded and will be put up online at our College of Complexes archive, where you can take a look at it through www.collegeofcomplexes.org. Click on the link on the camera there, and you'll see archives for the last 6 years available. You can also access it at my own website at www.timsvideo.com. Now, all right, as Brum always says, without further ado, let's introduce our speaker. Dr. Robert Holland returns with another scholarly essay in which he states that, since the dawn of modern consciousness, mankind has formulated concepts, metaphors, frameworks, and other abstractions enabling us to encounter outer reality and process it as inner experience. Smuggled in with this false dichotomy, the separation of mind and body is a fundamental alienation from the world and lack of embeddedness where various mental substitutes assume ever greater significance and block accurate appreciation of reality. We are now living in a world of illusions, almost solely in our own heads, discounting and or ignoring the mandates of reality in favor of purely mental phenomena. Substitution is the name of the game. Let's welcome Dr. Robert Holland. Sir, the lectern is all yours, sir.
Just like the guy you're counting.
Well, I see I'm able to draw a robust crowd tonight. Thank you for showing up. This is my 10th speech before the College of Complexes. Like all of my other speeches, this one is about human consciousness, although I have whittled the subject matter down to just one aspect of human consciousness. The familiar Sesame Street verse teaches a childhood lesson, namely that one of these things is not like the other. However, distinguishing and categorizing are more nearly opposing concepts, and collapsing disparate things and ideas within roughly interchangeable categories has for millennia been a perilous game of substitution. Material substitution is the more obvious manifestation, but I'm also concerned with mental substitution, where ideas in the abstract are exchanged recklessly, and as with many trends exhibiting exponential curves, the reification of ideas, that is, their conversion into concrete things, has accelerated and caused appreciation of reality to lose coherence and connection. I will discuss several historical antecedents that have enabled the substitution game and survey instances of how it is occurring today. Prior to the classical cultures of ancient Greek and Rome, proto-consciousness is believed to have been characterized by complete identification with and submersion in the immediate environment, where, for example, boundaries between animate and inanimate were fluid. This worldview is called animism, and may have survived among indigenous peoples into the late 20th century, but has been largely extinguished anywhere civilization has spread. In high distinction, the principal feature of modern consciousness, coalescing out of animism some 3,000 to 5,000 years ago, is the notion of self as distinguished from other, a hardened ego boundary separating and alienating the individual ego from others and from nature. Much like an infant is ejected from the womb or Adam and Eve, were expelled from the Garden of Eden. A related conceptual division is between the mind and body mentioned in the blurb before. So this is admittedly a brutally short summary and is probably not very helpful unless one is already familiar with these concepts or has attended enough of my speeches in the past to hear me speak. But the appearance of various forms of alienation from the world, typically expressed as dualisms, are significant because they prepared for Plato's allegory of the cave, which supposed that reality, the true essence of the world, lies beyond our grasp, since we perceive only its shadow on the cave wall. Whereas Plato's allegory is the first, or whether Plato's allegory is the first instance of severing of thing from thing prime, or thing from meta-thing, is nonetheless foundational in Western culture. We now live in the world of thing prime, where appearances and ideologies mask and substitute for the truth. In a sense, we fell into the habit of lying to ourselves and allowed pretense to become more influential than actuality. Since the time of Plato, people have suffered from war, famine, disease, and chaos, followed by periods of recovery and stasis. Some beliefs, technologies, and practices were retained, others vanished. The process was dynamic, organic, and muddling. The essential narrative was that when things were going well, the chief, emperor, or king had the mandate of heaven. When things were going badly, he, and I emphasize he because the world is full of patriarchies, has lost its mandate. The narrative instills respect for ancestors by attempting to hand down accumulated wisdom and traditional ways precisely because they had ensured survival in the past and were likely to do so again in the future. Another foundational example of the substitution game in antiquity is the Christian doctrine of Jesus having died for our sins on the cross. The line from the Bible at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24 is, "He himself bore our sins in his body on the stake so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds we were healed." The sacrament of penance and its ritual forgiveness of sin is a recapitulation of what is sometimes called substitutionary atonement. The transactional nature of these exchanges is also found in modern jurisprudence, where crimes and punishments, though not strictly identical, form a rough symmetry. Animism and ego consciousness are not the same thing by any stretch, but they at least share two valuable attributes: internal consistency and generational continuity. From our 21st century perspective, neither worldview hews too closely to material reality, but they both have a stronger claim on cultural coherence than anything available to us today. So then comes modernism, and with it the abandonment of tradition in favor of the notion that human society is always redefining itself, and by that refinement, things can eventually be perfected. Progress, in quotes, is the ideology that innovation and change have put humanity on an upward path and are always good without qualification. Accordingly, when modernism took hold, people offered reasoned arguments why human affairs would be better if they were revised instead of following ancestral tradition. Those reasoned arguments often use scientific evidence or theory as the basis for action. So casting my eye across this vast panorama of time, from the prehistoric over the Greeks and Romans, the Enlightenment, and up to the present day, 10,000 years all told, never has the world changed so fast and so completely as it has in my own lifetime. For most of history, things stayed much the same for hundreds of years, generation after generation. So what parents had learned was what one needed to look to know, and what children needed to know was the same as their grandparents knew before them. It's not like that now. in the last century especially, instead of clever people addressing basic philosophical problems dealing with the nature of human existence alongside, I should point out, other living beings on Earth, they devise ever more horrible and devastating ways to kill more efficiently. Or they build bigger, faster supercomputers and social networks so that we can transition into a transhumanist dystopia filled with celebrity gossip and cute cat videos. It's difficult and somewhat arbitrary to put a location or a date on the origin of modernism, but it may well be that the English Industrial Revolution, the rise of a wealthy middle class, and the development of liberal capitalist ideology in the 18th century was the start. Or maybe origins were earlier in the Renaissance and the Reformation or the Enlightenment, all of which were fundamental revisions of earlier ways of life. Once the ball started rolling, however, it gathered momentum as people gained confidence. Only slightly later, the French and American revolutions both embodied a gathering of ideas that change is good and human progress using new ideologies, including technology, is the way to go, and further, that creativity, liberty, and individuality are all virtues, none of which are particularly welcome in typical conservative traditional cultures. The experiment has been running several centuries now to see which view is right, traditionalists or modernists, and we end up where we are now in the postmodern soup. Without falling victim to a misplaced nostalgia for the good old days that weren't really so good after a bit of circumspection, I submit that despite the obvious advantages in terms of lifespan and living standards, modernism has led to catastrophe and chaos because despite being putatively based on Enlightenment rationality, logic, and reason, the modernist argument for relentless change, improving our material circumstances, and dispensing with tradition can never be proved conclusively other than quantitatively, which is an abysmal substitute for quality and meaning of life across a broad range of criteria. The contest ends up being a hopeless Tower of Babel, unintelligible in all its endless varieties and interpretations. And yet, I predict that in someone's rebuttal, the argument will resort to exactly those arguments, that we live much better lives now than we ever had, despite our spiritual vacuity. This endless variety of interpretation and reinterpretation is probably best exemplified in the postmodern practice of assembling ideologies piecemeal from among available options without regard to context or consistency. In politics, it's found in avoidance of clear policy, substituting instead sound bites in the cult of personality, thing prime for actual thing. In religion, it's found in fetishized versions of worship that select dogma and doctrine without regard to the overall thrust of a particular faith. One example is the messianic Jewish evangelical organization called Jews for Jesus. Just ponder that basic irony for a moment. Today, many churches allow liberalized versions of faith that unify not behind a central authority, but rather behind the notion that the individual can concoct his or her own hodgepodge religion best suited to him or herself. Unitarian Universalism is one further example. The proper term for this is syncretism, but of course we have substitutes for that term for those who are challenged by vocabulary. I've heard the term called cafeteria Catholicism, and in his book Why We Hate Us, Dick Meyer calls it Sheilaism after his example practitioner. Those substitutes are less descriptive, of course, than syncretism, but the first is alliterative, and the second has the verisimilitude of the anecdote. Let me return briefly to antiquity for a last example of how deeply the changeover of thought runs. According to Oswald Spengler, author of The Decline of the West, from 1926, the ancient Greek number sense is sensuous. It relates directly to surfaces, especially planar ones, such as walls and even ground or still water. It refers as well to bodies or forms readily perceptible and measurable in the immediate environment. Magnitude is the principal theoretical attribute. As a result, negative numbers, most irrational numbers, and exponential powers greater than 3 lie beyond the scope of classical Greek thought because they are not embodied in everyday sensual experience. In contrast, modern mathematics provides a wide range of abstract concepts with function being the principal attribute. Numbers are understood primarily in relation to each other and without reference to specific embodiments. Spengler's example is the Cartesian coordinate system, which plots points, lines, curves, figures, and bodies in absolute space. This is essentially the difference between direct and indirect articles. The angle, block, line, or ball of the Greeks versus a angle, block, ball, or line of the Cartesians. Whereas the Greeks thought in terms of actuality, Cartesians think more readily in terms of possibility, or in ontological terms, not become, but becoming. Again, thing and thing prime. More problematically, geometrical constructs take on idealized forms that lose congruence with their inevitably fixed and flawed embodiments. And even further, numbers themselves are better understood in their abstract representations, such as x squared plus y squared equals z squared, as opposed to 3 squared plus 4 squared equals 5 squared. Extend the idea of abstract disembodied forms and numbers to entire cultures and economies, and one gets fiat currencies that count debt, literally a negative number or absence of money or deficit, as an asset and cling stubbornly to the wholly mistaken idea of infinite growth on a finite planet. So let's consider fiat currency for a moment. Like penance and other atonements, currency is essentially transactional, providing an efficient means of exchange, also known as liquidity. Specific embodiments of currency have varied over time, but they all require majority adoption by populations to function. In turn, currencies become complex sociological constructs. Just over a century ago, banks in the US issued their own local currencies, often based on their literal exchange value for silver or gold, precious metals having been understood for thousands of years as possessing inherent value due to their rarity. In response to a series of financial panics, the Federal Reserve System was formed in 1913, establishing central control over the monetary system. The gold standard existed in the US, not without its difficulties, until 1971, when the Nixon administration ended the US dollar's convertibility into gold. Thus, currency based solely on executive fiat, thing and thing prime. Social consensus is still needed to make fiat currency work, which has not yet been challenged significantly, except perhaps by the recent appearance of digital currencies such as Bitcoin, sometimes called virtual currency or cryptocurrency, depending on how it functions. These may be the opening salvos in what could develop into currency wars should national currencies fail following a new panic or crisis of confidence. Thus far, one needs both nerves of steel and excess disposable income to speculate in digital currencies. They're barely even spendable anywhere, so it's just a loose investment right now for those who expect that they will undergo widespread adoption. More commonplace are gold and silver bugs who stack precious metals in anticipation of financial collapse. Some of you may also recall a vigorous trade in, of all things, Beanie Babies. One of the most valueless commodities that for a time commanded exorbitant prices. Fiat currency is just one example of how Western economies have substituted notional wealth for actual wealth. Since the 19th century, the U.S. has transitioned from an agrarian economy to one based on manufacturing, then services, then information, each being incrementally more removed from basic resources. Call this thing prime, thing double prime, thing triple prime, etc. Shell games played by banks and governments are called financialization these days, and now account for the greater part of gross national product. So economic activity is driven by moving money around with instruments of exchange so complex no one understands them anymore. Indeed, they're intended to be entirely inscrutable by their designers. This approach is the end game described by Spengler, where abstraction and ideology control what ought to be relatively straightforward mechanisms, such as price discovery via supply and demand. But then again, Beanie Babies. Lest anyone believe that these procedural substitutes are markers of healthy economic activity, let me provide a quick snapshot of where money is flowing. Quoting from a blog post at tomdispatch.com, published in February of this year. Here I quote, "In January, Oxfam released a report on the widening gap between global wealth and poverty. It found that between 2010 and today, wealth of the poorest half of the planet's population fell by $1 trillion, a drop of 41%, while that of the richest 62 people, 53 men and 9 women, increased by $500 billion. Put another way, those 62 billionaires are wealthier than the bottom 50% of the world's population, while the richest 1% owned more than the other 99% combined. The direction in which we're headed is obvious. Just consider that in 2010, it took 388 of the super rich to equal the holdings of the bottom 50%. Now that number is 326 people smaller," end quote. No one could possibly believe that pooling so much wealth and control in the hands of so few people contributes to healthy societies, yet our adherence to ideologies such as the profit motive and laissez-faire capitalism, not to mention straight-up criminal corruption, encourage imbalances that ensure destabilization and collapse. Shifting gears now, one of the most alarming instances of the substitution game is the loss of wild animal populations to human populations. Put another way, we're substituting ourselves for wild animals in nature, partly by killing them and consuming them, partly by killing them outright as pests or competing predators, partly by converting their habitat into ours, and partly by inadvertently changing the climate and thus altering their habitat and our own. Vaclav Smil's book, Harvesting the Biosphere, What We Have Taken from Nature, dating from 2013, is a fascinating inventory of current estimated biomass of the Earth compared to historical estimates. Although the book is dense with methodology, terminology, and numerical data, I'll report on just land animals. According to Smil, estimated global anthropomass, which is people, in the year 1900 was 13 megatons carbon. Carbon is a dry weight measure of biomass developed by scientists, and so humans were equal to 13 megatons. Wild mammalian zoo mass, on the other hand, was 10. Elephants were 3. Domesticated animals were 35, and cattle were 23. By 2000, the numbers had changed to anthropomass 55, wild mammalian zoo mass 5, elephants 0.3, domesticated animals 120, and cattle 80. So in just 100 years, wild mammals have decreased by 50%, elephants have decreased by 90%, humans have increased more than fourfold, and domestic animals and cattle have each increased more than threefold. That is the substitution game. Wanton killing of wild animals is especially heinous in the case of so-called romance animals, such as lions, tigers, bears, elephants, rhinos, and whales. Most of us were outraged by the needless killing of Cecil the lion by a Minnesota dentist. However, the slaughter extends to predators such as wolves, foxes, and coyotes, often for the purpose of protecting the financial interests of ranchers. An exposé called Rogue Agency in the March 2016 issue of Harper's Magazine reports that since 2000, operatives of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, here I begin a quote, have killed at least 2 million native mammals and 15 million native birds. Many of these animals are iconic in the American West and beloved by the public. Several are listed as endangered or threatened under the Endangered Species Act. In 2014 alone, wildlife services killed 322 wolves, 61,702 coyotes, 2,930 foxes, 580 black bears, 796 bobcats, 5 golden eagles, and 3 bald eagles. The agency also killed tens of thousands of beavers, squirrels, and prairie dogs. End quote. I find it curious that the records of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Administration, or service, pardon me, would be so complete that they could count those numbers down to the single digit, that they aren't rounded off, showing that they know exactly what they're doing. The agency's enabling legislation is the 1931 Animal Damage Control Act, which is directed to have them conduct campaigns for the destruction or control of animals injurious to agriculture. Any claims to right to life of wild animals are simply swept aside. I should also point out that since its inception in 1885, the agency has undergone numerous name changes, substituting one euphemism for another, just like the U.S. Department of War became the U.S. Department of Defense to conceal its true nature. An article in Harper's from the previous month reports the flip side, namely the astonishing increase in the number of food animals and their associated wastes. For instance, Iowa is the home to about 21 million hogs, each producing the same amount of waste produced by about 2.5 people. Thus, Iowa produces the hog shit equivalent of about 45 million people, some 15 times its human population. Iowa also has 52 million laying chickens, the bulk concentrated in inhumane animal feeding operations, each holding more than 100,000 birds. These birds also produce more manure than do all the people in the state. Little of it is subjected to sewage treatment before draining into public waterways, and as a result, much of Iowa's fresh water is suffused with nitrates, which is an ongoing ecological disaster. Turning now from the olfactory to the auditory, Bernie Krause is a soundscape ecologist, and his book, Voices of the Wild, subtitle Animal Songs, Human Din, and the Call to Save Natural Soundscapes, dating from 2015, describes how nature is falling silent as it is emptied out and degraded through human appropriation and climate change. Krause calls the sounds of animals in nature biophony, whereas non-biological sounds, such as wind in trees and running water, are called geophony. Krause's studies of biophonic expression indicate collapsing density and diversity across a variety of criteria. For instance, the California drought, likely the result of climate change, anthropogenic climate change, I might add, has completely silenced birdsong in the Valley of the Moon in Sonoma Valley. Calling attention to a visual aspect that further exposes human impacts on nature, scotobiology is the study of the biology of darkness, which contrasts with photobiology, the study of the biology of light, including photosynthesis. Almost all biological systems evolve in a world of alternating day and night and are dependent upon daily and seasonal patterns of light and darkness. Many plants, animals, insects, and microorganisms are adversely affected by nighttime light pollution from human civilization, which disturbs foraging, breeding, and other social behaviors, especially in amphibians and insects. One well-known example is sea turtles that orient themselves by moonlight reflected off the surface of water. Lighted beachfront properties disorient the hatchlings, which crawl toward the wrong light source and die in the sand from dehydration before reaching water. Speaking of reaching for water. Light pollution affects humans as well. Astronomy and the cosmology have fascinated us from before the beginning of recorded history. In fact, the term cosmology often substitutes for philosophy precisely because cosmology invites us to contemplate our position within the universe. We developed constellations, mythologies, and religions associated with the skies and the underworld to provide context and meaning for human life on this planet. Now, with human populations concentrated in cities where the night sky is blocked by glare, we no longer look skyward in fascination and awe. No more father sun, no more sister moon. Instead, we're given clinically accurate descriptions of the solar system and surrounding galaxy as orbital bodies lacking immanence and meaning. Surprisingly, many people still believe that the moon emits light rather than reflecting sunlight. These same people often reject the heliocentric model of the solar system and believe in, among other things, a biblical flat earth. So here I must admit, the provocation for preparing this speech was another College of Complexes speech that failed to convince me. The question posed in that speech was, are we becoming zombies with respect to our smartphone habits? The speech ended up being a scared straight interdiction about texting while driving and completely missed the larger point that we have allowed what's displayed on tiny handheld screens to substitute for the proper focus of our limited attention. Just like you are what you eat, you are also what you think. And if your information diet is dominated by electronic garbage, then I submit the contents of your mind are full of garbage as well. I could point to Nicholas Carr, author of The Shallows from 2011 and The Glass Cage from 2015, which I have reported on before. He writes about media theory and neuroplasticity, which is the newfound science that's discovered that thoughts in the brain actually rewire your brain to encourage repetition and reinforce those thoughts. Or I could point to Kirkpatrick Sale, whose book Rebels Against the Future from 1995 is about Bloodism, both historical and present. But instead I'll point to Sven Burkertz, a teacher of writing at Bennington College and a celebrated literary critic. He's also the author of a book famous in its day called The Gutenberg Elegies, subtitled The Fate of Reading in an Electronic Age, the date of that book being 1994. This may have been among the first book-length diatribes skeptical of the internet and what was then emerging and is now apparent as digital culture. I haven't read the Gutenberg elegies. Instead, I picked up this book called Changing the Subject, Art and Attention in the Internet Age. This dates from 2015. So I had expected Burkert to have come to some conclusions in his more recent book, but I surmise that he's been essentially writing the same book or series of books now for over 20 years. His principal complaint has always been how digital communications have diverted attention away from books, a schism between the respective tribes of the book and screen. One might argue that reading is reading, whether using an e-reader, a computer, a smartphone, a printed magazine, or a book. Let me caution you, however, none of these things are just like the other. In 1964, Marshall McLuhan coined the phrase, "The medium is the message," observing that, and here I quote from Wikipedia, "The form of a medium embeds itself in the message, creating a symbiotic relationship where the medium influences how the message is perceived." End quote. Here I will give you a demonstration how the medium is the message, and the medium influences and embeds in the message, changing how you perceive. Burkert is sensitive to these relationships, especially the way digital devices discourage deep reading, especially that of long-form writing, in favor of skimming and scanning of short, rapid-fire messages that carry the implicit goad, "made you look." The resulting loss of readership for, as just one example, the great American novel, is of grave concern to Burkert, as you would expect of a literary critic. In Changing the Subject, Burkert has a curious philosophical and even psycho-spiritual passage, which takes some time to absorb and digest. I don't expect to do it justice in this speech. It's much like the act of deep reading. In it, Burkert describes the world around us as needing our attention to rise into consciousness, which is an artifact of our humanist heritage, as distinguished from the inert cloud of data and disjunctive, decontextualized information found at, for example, Wikipedia. Here I quote from the book. "There's something both visions invoke, though in very different ways. This is the transformation of the old material given, the world, our natural origin. The digital path would move us away by building a new world with new human rules and placing it squarely atop the old, supplanting formerly unmediated things and experiences with their designed and perfected digital correlates," end quote. This is an especially apt description of thing and thing prime, which is the basis of my thesis of my speech tonight, except that it's generalized across our entire information diet, which is essentially a shared cognitive environment that forms a new phenomenology of digital living. It's easily observed when people memorialize experience by recording video on their cell phones of events they should be experiencing without mediation. It's also the root motivation of the selfie craze, where an experience is incomplete until it's captured and posted on Instagram. Even the solitary act of distance running is now accompanied by a soundtrack played from arm or belt-mounted media players. This used to be the Sony Walkman, and then the Discman, and then the iPod, but now playback is built into smartphones. Indeed, I often call the ubiquitous earbuds people now wear in public to stay jacked in protective headgear, precisely because they also function to prohibit human interaction. A somewhat more widespread and visceral reaction prevented mass adoption of the Google Glass, though that may only be temporary as wearable computing and virtual reality devices continue to be refined. Thus, we live in the world of Thing Prime. But the original thing is better understood without filters and without mediation. Burgertz writes that Rainer Maria Rilke's admonition from a very different cultural moment was that we, quote, take the world in, swallow it in our living, and then labor to spin it into the stuff of higher awareness, end quote. Of course, higher awareness can never be achieved when the deluge of information flowing at us like a fire hose never stops. Burgertz goes on to describe a set of human behaviors, including thinking, initiative, creativity, subjective self-grounding, and formulation of private and social meaning in terms of the vertical and horizontal. The handy examples borrowed from Nicholas Carr in this case, which were borrowed in turn from a book by Eric Raymond about open source software development, are the cathedral, with its beauty, transcendence, and hierarchical structure, versus the bazaar, which spreads across space without design or coherence. Here I quote again from the book. Could it be that we are letting the capacities of the internet define the terms of the conversation? There is no deep time in this field of flickering impulses, and much of what defines us, contemplation, aesthetic immersion, and the sustaining resonance of human interaction, only happens when there is deep time and attention. But where and how are we to parse these questions when most parsing, indeed most everything, happens within the field of digital signals? End quote. So if the Enlightenment mind is the cathedral, which is to say vertical, individual, penetrating, profound, and inward, the digital mind is the bazaar, horizontal, shared, and directed at what is just over the horizon, typically following a trail laid for us by corporate interests. The difference is, in short, between the mind that thinks for the sake of itself and the mind oriented toward popularity as measured by likes, pins, tweets and retweets, blogs and reblogs, and trend analysis as ideas are picked up and discarded in an endless rush to raise one's pet topics into others' consciousness. So I will admit here that I've borrowed a few phrases, not specifically from the book, but rather from a book review that I'll provide the title. It's called Ghost in the Machine by Jenny Hendrix, and it was published in October 2015 at bostonreview.com. If you don't have the time or interest or inclination to pick up this book, that book review is an excellent summary of what the book has on offer. If you're more inclined to technophilia, and Burkert's unstinting technophobia fails to register, perhaps you should consider not just the world we have right now, but the world we're designing for ourselves. Robotics in particular are projected to displace or substitute for a majority of workers and diminish human labor considerably. The process has already been underway for decades and is already evidenced in self-service lanes and kiosks, ATMs, online booking and reservations, and automated customer phone service lines that succeed in helping exactly no one. Robotic intrusions are also growing in frequency and annoyance, but just wait until every device, including home security, vehicles, and even refrigerators, are tracked alongside phone and social media data, forming a complete picture of your habits and associations, fine-tuned down to the minute. Very soon, we will all be marks in a combination commercial and political leviathan that already sees us as commodities to be surveilled, packaged, and sold for profit, or co-opted for political gain. This is the conclusion and prediction of an article by Shoshana Zuboff called The Secrets of Surveillance Capitalism, which argues that scavenging of behavioral data will soon enable direction of behaviors at the scale of entire societies. The parasitic nature of extracting information from the citizenry who willingly contribute much of it via Facebook and other social media, with the blithe recognition that we've already jettisoned privacy simply by being online, and the profoundly anti-democratic power that arises from surveillance contribute to what is now called inverted totalitarianism, where, quoting again from Wikipedia, corporations have corrupted and subverted democracy, and where economics trumps politics. I'm sorry, I stumbled on that word, Trump. In inverted totalitarianism, every natural resource and every living being is commodified and exploited to collapse as the citizenry is lulled and manipulated into surrendering their liberties and their participation in government through excess consumerism and sensationalism. All of that comes from the Wikipedia article on inverted totalitarianism. Thus, we are fed a constant stream of disinformation in American life, a series of pretensions diverging from what they say they are, such as two-hour waiting lines at O'Hare while TSA conducts security theater, a police department that far too frequently victimizes the citizenry it's sworn to protect and serve, municipal, state, and federal governments that fail to govern effectively. At this point, I ask, how long has the state of Illinois been operating without a budget? A little over a year now? And ongoing foreign wars that arguably make it less safe for us than if we had simply stayed home and saved ourselves the trouble, expense, and loss of life. The stage is also set later this year for the most fractious presidential election in living memory, with both parties nominating conventions promising to be hotly contested and the likelihood of escalating street violence very high. James Howard Kunstler summarized the political cultural moment at his blog, Clusterfuck Nation, in March of this year. Here I quote, "The effects of all this fundamental dishonesty have thundered through our national life to the degree that American society is now divided into the swindlers and the swindled. Loosing the monster of collective id known as Trump on the public. This is what comes of attempting to divorce truth from reality, which has been the principal business of American life for several decades now. When truth and reality become delinked, a society literally doesn't know what it's doing. With that goes the collective sense of purpose, replaced with bromides and platitudes such as Trump's Make America Great Again and Hillary's In America, Every Family Should Feel Like They Belong." End quote. In conclusion, if hipster irony associated with the postmodern era, takes reversal of meaning and paradoxical retention of opposites as prime characteristics, the post-ironic era, to coin a phrase, expands issues from false dualism, such as George Bush's either you're with us or you're against us, takes those dualisms and expands them into multifaceted free-for-alls where anyone's wild interpretation of facts, events, policy and strategy has roughly equal footing with another's precisely because no authority exists to satisfy everyone as to the truth of matters. The cacophony of competing viewpoints, the multiple things prime, if you will, conjured from assemblages of evidence and opinion, virtually guarantees that someone out there, probably someone loony, will speak or write as though reading your mind. So you don't trust politicians or scientists or news anchors, pundits, teachers, academics, your parents, clerics, or even the Pope? No problem. Just belly up to the ideological buffet and cherry pick from available viewpoints. No matter that few have much plausibility, it's a smorgasbord of options, and none can be discarded out of hand for being too far beyond the pale. All must be tried and entertained. As a result, reality has dissolved into a stew of competing arguments, often extremely politicized. Historically, the principal conflict was between different epistemologies or ways of knowing, exemplified by faith and reason, or perhaps better understood as church versus state, or pardon me, church versus science. Floodgates have now opened to any substitute one might choose, coexisting on equal footing in the marketplace of ideas. For example, the primary proxy for personal success in the affluent West, although Asian Pacific countries are quickly catching up, is wealth, which is not so much a way of knowing or constructing meaning as it is a way of having, and having, and having more, and more, and more. We have collectively lost our grip on matters of supreme importance, questions of philosophical and cosmological significance, and entered into a bizarro phase filled with spectacle and chaos, more in keeping with cinematic dystopianism than with the consensus view of modern history. Stepping outside the twisted frame of the dominant paradigm allows a few intrepid souls to see the truth more clearly for what it is and call bullshit on the rest. I'm still sorting it out with no particular goal in mind and zero expectation that I can convince anyone of anything. In the meantime, human consciousness appears to be breaking through to a new type of immersion, not immersion in nature or books, but rather in a projected holographic virtual reality that runs on pure ideation, inside the purview of industrial civilization and divorced from material reality. How quickly will it all break down once the electrical grid fails and we discover that our LinkedIn network is lost and that family news shared among far-flung relatives gathered via Facebook cannot be updated? That possibility lies closer at hand than anyone wants to admit. It almost happened following the 2008 financial collapse. Regrettably, we have no ready substitute in the event of social collapse. We've left coherent society behind. Thank you.
Okay.
Do you want to take care of questions by yourself, or would you like somebody to moderate with you tonight?
I think it's a small group. I'd be more.
Okay. That's fine. Well, he'll take your questions now, and I'm going to have the first one.
I've often said that I like the benefits of modern technology, particularly things like washing machines, electric motors, things like this. I'd like to know your view. Do you view technology and some of the things that we're doing as inherently evil, or can it be channeled in a way that would make life better?
Does technology possess inherent evil, or can it be channeled for the good?
Yes.
For the better life?
Mm-hmm.
All of that is predicated on how you would define the better life. Clearly, on the numbers, lifespan, material wealth, health and well-being, we've improved dramatically.
Okay.
That's not an issue for me. That's a given. I'll grant that entirely.
Okay.
However, on a cultural level, we are in collapse, notwithstanding the numerical data to support how well we're doing.
Right.
Does technology in and of itself, as a product of human imagination, possess evil I'm not sure I would go that far. If evil exists in the world, it's in us, not our technologies. So to adopt the familiar catchphrase, it's not the guns that kill people, it's people that kill people.
Okay. Okay. And our...
Yeah. What do you see... let's put it this way. Do you have any hope for the near 10, 15, 20 years for the human race? And if so, what do you think people can do to make society move forward in a beneficial direction? How could we improve society with what we have to work with today?
Earlier in the speech, I cited the aspect of progress. That's one of our religions now. And what you're asking is, how can we have more progress? And I think that without being a full-on Luddite, probably what we need is retrogression. We need to go back to a time that was simpler, more localized, less complex and confusing, and more based on non-electronic connection among people. Do I have hope for that? None at all. We set ourselves on a trajectory hundreds of years ago, and very few people, I would count Sven Burgers as one, even recognize that there's a dilemma in our modern way of life. Most people are too tickled by their new iPhones.
What is the author's name of that book?
Sven, S-V-E-N, Burkerts, B-I-R, K-E-R-T-S. His better known book is called The Gutenberg Elegies from 21 years ago. This one that I've been holding up is called Changing the Subject.
Changing the Subject.
Yes. Okay. Question over here.
In cultures where the dualism isn't as well developed, in the Asian cultures, Eastern cultures, where individualism isn't nurtured or reified, how would your arguments toward technology and treatment of the world translate there, or how do they fit with that kind of culture?
As I said in the speech, anywhere that modern industrial civilization has penetrated has pretty much extinguished any alternative to modern consciousness. Within that framework, there are ranges of how people see themselves in relation to society at large. In the United States, we're probably in the vanguard with respect to rugged individualism, go it on your own, pull yourself up from your bootstraps, and all the usual rhetoric. In comparison, I would say that Japan is probably one of the most cohesive and self-effacing, which is to say, not absorbed in the self societies on the planet right now, but yet, how fully are they embedded in electronic culture? Even more than we are, in fact. In case you haven't heard of it, there's a term for grown men who have, since the age of 13 or 14, become so involved in video games that at some point they basically just hid themselves away in their basements and played video games nonstop for as long as they could stay awake or even stay alive, because some of them have died at it from embolisms of one sort or another. And it's a widespread, not, I don't know how widespread it is in Japan, but I haven't heard about it occurring in the United States. The term for it in Japan is the Hokkaido, I think. If I have that right, I might not.
They refer to the last maybe 30 years now in Japan, from the 90s, almost 20, at least 25 years, as the lost decades. Can you comment on that with your theory of ever more progress and spending and consumption?
The lost decades refers to a financial stagnation in Japan, which before China had threatened to overtake the United States in terms of growth and overall wealth. Is that correct? It's more of an economic term than it is a cultural term.
I don't know enough about Japan to know if it's not one and the same thing, being that culture and
economics and culture and politics and religion, they're all tied together, of course. They're not discrete categories of thing. As it happens, I traveled to Japan twice in the 1990s and had a firsthand experience there. And they were supremely nice people and seemed fairly curious of my presence there among them because the look of Japanese people is pretty much all the same. Mostly shorter, thin, black hair, as opposed to me. At that time I had blonde hair and blue eyes. So they were curious about me. And of course I didn't speak Japanese. And many of them liked to approach me on the street to speak English or to practice their English. Do I have a sense, though, that they lacked individuality? I don't think so. I know that the thrust of their society, though, is to give up their individuality for the greater good of their society, in the same way that is imposed from on top in China as a result of communist ideology. I'm not sure that answers your question.
I was just wondering if Japan's lost decades were a result of a non-Western people rejecting Western ways. Similar to the question here about Asian culture, not following the path that we lay down.
My sense is that China and Japan, especially the two modern economies in Asia compared to, say, Indonesia or Thailand or Vietnam or even, well, Korea is also in that group, I think. They have embraced Western-style capitalism and brought in with it the capitalist ethic of profit and wealth as markers of individual success. How fully can they transform the Asian mind into the Western mind, considering that they come from their own cultural heritage of thousands of years? I couldn't really say. That's a larger anthropological comparison than I'm equipped to make.
Okay. Yeah, doctor, I don't know what you're a doctor of. Are you a doctor of philosophy, or what is your doctorate in?
My doctorate is in music.
But you seem like you're giving a philosophical viewpoint of modern living. And one of the things, you know, you made a lot of observations about things that are actually going on. But at the same time, you never gave us any solutions about how we should go back to the past. You know, you seem to be reactionary. You say, well, whatever we're doing today with all the media things, that's not good because we're disconnected. Let's go back to the way things were in the 19th century where, you know, we didn't have telephones, we didn't have TV, you know, and I don't know how millennials react to what you're saying, because there's a lot of good, and I grant you there's bad things, but there's a lot of good things in modern society. But you haven't really identified for us how we could progress with what we have into the future. Good.
There's that word again, progress. Your question also presupposes that there is a solution to a problem. And I don't believe that the flow of history is a problem bearing solutions. At best, it's a thing to be understood in hindsight, considerable hindsight often, but here we are in the thick of things and we're in a transitional moment. And so my attempt is merely to understand it and to penetrate through the fog as best as I can to become as authentic a person as I can in defiance of all of the noise that is attempting to infect my thinking. So I avoided offering a solution. I avoided offering even a response, because I don't believe that there is one that makes sense at the scale of society, precisely because culture flows in directions no one can control. And the attempt to control it has, in history, always been met with disaster.
Maybe a hint at a solution would be, is there any way we could substitute humans for these areas that were, you know, I think you're arguing substituting humans in a lot of areas like money, animals, electronics, making humans dominant in all the areas and wiping out everything else. Is there any way we could not make humans so central, do you say?
That would be a start. However, it's not consistent with Christian or Enlightenment philosophy that instructs us to go forth and multiply, to dominate the earth, to manage our resources to our own ends, etc., etc., as though none of the rest of the world has any say in how we act. And of course it doesn't, because of the fact that we possess most of the power. Once in a while, a shark or a bear or some other animal, a gorilla maybe, will get a hold of a human being, and you know what happens to them in that event. So the specialness of human existence is raised above everything else, which must make way for us. Would that be a solution to turn things around? Probably. Do I see it happening? Not one bit. Go ahead.
Speaking of millennials, to observe, okay, they don't care about automobiles. They apparently don't shop in malls. They use a lot of bicycles. They they don't see color, all right? They don't see sexual orientation the way that we did just 40 years ago. Many, many good things. They have their traits. This is a change in a good direction that's happening culturally. So I disagree that there's no hope.
That would be a rebuttal, not a question.
Do you agree with me?
No. Certainly not every change is a bad change. The civil rights era and the equal rights era and the liberalization of identity, I guess, are positive effects that we can observe right now in our lifetimes. So I wouldn't say that everything is going to help, but my perspective is a little broader than that, not quite as fine-grained as the exceptions that you've offered up. I might even suggest that the millennial abandonment of things that we consider standard or normal is part of this transition into a style of immersion in virtual reality and a giving away of the individual identity that has defined most of the West for 400 years. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Hard to say exactly, but it's observable in its initial stages. Another question?
Yeah, did you ever run across the work of Buckminster Fuller?
I've heard the name, but I couldn't comment on him. I don't know enough about him.
He was a famous architect. He designed energy-efficient houses and other things. He was a tremendous thinker. He wrote a book in 1984 called Critical Path. And in that, he said, every 5 years, we get as much progress or technological movement as the previous 50. You know, things are getting, like you talk about, progress is getting crowded closer and closer together year by year. And he was looking for some way to, you know, help humanity move into the future without being overwhelmed by this condensing of progress so fast that people couldn't cope with it. I wonder, what have you run across any other authors that have talked about that concept?
Actually, I have. I read a book some time ago called Faster, the Acceleration of Practically Everything. I don't remember the author's name, but his argument was exactly what you said, this condensation into shorter and shorter time units of complete disorienting change and fluctuation, where people would have to reinvent and reimagine and come to terms with completely new ways of doing things that didn't exist just a short time ago. And that's what we've seen. I would pick my own childhood as a point of reference for me. Others might pick a slightly earlier date before the onset of television or a slightly later date before the onset of the computer communications era. But all of them can be seen crescendoing into this fury of change and flux, and it's ongoing. Is that a good thing? I would say absolutely not. And I tried to point that out in the speech by saying that generational continuity has disappeared, and that the knowledge of our ancestors has been surpassed and supplanted by ever faster and different ways of doing and knowing. Are there any further questions?
Okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah, you said they were listening in on, isn't there no privacy anymore with the FCC? We went to a church group and they were taping in and recording on cell phones, threatening us with Scarface and stuff because we said it's, I worked in law, I say it's in the bylaws. Cannot be recorded in the meetings. How do you feel about all that?
I feel that participating in modern life, in a public life, in any fashion or all, at all, carries with it the implication of loss of privacy. I mean, I'm being recorded right now as I speak, and it'll go up on the web, and somebody's going to look at it. I'm not pleased with it.
We don't have to post it, but...
You could have told him not to tape it.
Yeah.
We were so shocked on Wednesday. We were in a church rectory with priests, and the guy kept going like this. What? He had heart trouble? No, he's recording on the cell phone.
Millennials have no problem with that, I should point out. I was sitting in a lunch meeting with some co-workers, many of whom are in their 30s and 20s, and they just said, you just need to update and get with the times, man. It's already gone. And of course, it is already gone. But they just, you know, wave it away like it's no big deal and nothing they can do, and probably there is nothing they can do except that you don't have to participate with all the same verve and gusto by putting everything out there about yourself, or by saying to your pastor who's recording to the church meeting.
He wasn't recording, it was the member.
Okay, some other member, anybody surveilling, infiltrating, and then sharing what happens behind closed doors. You don't have to go along with that.
Yeah.
You don't have to participate in every public affair as though there's nothing for you to do but succumb.
We were shocked because it said in the bylaws, do not used cell phones and so on. Thank you very much.
Well, I had hoped to,
that was the best part of the
enough
speech.
People would be here that when I cracked a joke in my speech, somebody would laugh. I got one or two chuckles,
no.
But I came with my prop, and I was going to start recording to show you how people behave now, or maybe I should take a selfie of me giving a speech with everybody in the background. That's what people do now. And it's horrific to me.
Yes, you're right.
We don't have to put this recording online, you know.
If you say, don't sign a release.
Well, luckily I'm such a nobody, nobody would even.
Thank you for your thank you for your permission, then, just so that we can get it up. It's
yes, you have my permission.
Thank you very much.
Are there any further questions? I can exit the stage here. Give away
okay.
The podium.
Well. Then let us thank Dr. Holland. We appreciate your speech and the time you put into it. And seeing as how we have a little bit of time, does anybody object if we go to 7 minutes per rebuttal tonight?
Whoa, that's a long one.
Maybe six or seven. We'll go with a loosely affiliated 6 minutes. Meaning that if you're good and you know what you're talking about, we'll let you stay going along. Okay. Andy, if you're ready, come on up, but let's get you onto the phone. Unless you want me to go first.
Go first.
All right. If Dr. Holland is not here.
Do we press the start? Do we press the start button over there?
Go ahead and get there and go ahead and time.
Hit the green, right?
She'll figure out how to use it. I can usually tie myself because with my Toastmasters
okay.
Affiliations. All right.
Whoops.
Pause.
Okay, there we go.
This has been nothing more than similar arguments posted well over 100 years ago with the development of the electronic telegraph and its insistence upon getting the world into a worldwide communications network. Just imagine the fact that over 150 years ago, the speed at which news and travel and everything else transpired around the world was at roughly the pace of 4 miles an hour. Now just imagine all of a sudden a machine that comes in and almost instantaneously gives information overnight. You talk about radical and revolutionary change. That's exactly what happened during the Victorian times. But within the first messages that were transmitted way back in 1846, in less than a 20-year time period, we had the transatlantic cables and basically a worldwide internet, in a sense, because people could use it to get information. We had a development of the Reuters News Service, and yes, online shopping. The first large online business that was taken from a consumer grade was the good old gowns from the South, the crinoline gowns that were coming out of Paris with the fashion designer of Mason Worth. He would take telegraph orders, and 2 to 3 months later, you'd have your gown. We've often thought that what's new is not new. But at the same time, you know, people even back then were talking about the pace of life changing, how fast we need to take things into account. And we had some good things happen. There was the, you know, the rampant killing of the buffalo, the Transcontinental Railroad, the constant environmentalist degradation of heavy industry. But something good came out of it, and that was the birth of the national parks, for example. And it seemed that as we progressed in our machine age and people were brought to a higher standard of living, we seemed to care more about things about the environment and about the way the world works. I myself tend to take a look at things a little radically differently because I see as people develop and find themselves with longer lifespans, with more time, with more things, certain trends emerge, and the first one is that
our population's actually going to be going down or stabilizing in the next 10 to 15 years, and the median age of the world's going to rise. Why does that happen?
Are you talking about U.S. or worldwide?
Worldwide. Because as you get above about $8,000 in gross income, children are no longer a source of labor but an expense, and you don't have as many of them. The second thing I'd like to talk about too is that when you get development, such as fundamental things like electric power, you tend to see such things as the washing machine, the electric motor, things that fundamentally change people's lives from having to go from a constant drudgery of labor to the more intellectual things like teaching their kids how to read, getting more education involved. And it doesn't stop there. I like progress, but I think it also has to be managed. It used to be when you got a phone call for many years before the development of the answering machine, you'd take the call or you'd lose it. Now we have an answering machine. Now we have screening devices. We know how not to take a call from somebody. And the same thing's inevitably going to happen with email and cell phones and things like this. You're already starting to see it. They ask you to turn them off when you're in a public forum. They ask you, you know, in a lot of cases, not to record in a public forum. In a lot of other places, there's a certain amount of etiquette that needs to be caught up on this stuff. I think that progress is good. But I also think, too, that it takes a little while for social norms to catch up. Frankly, Dr. Holland, I like what you have to say. I think you have a very valid point. And a lot of what you're saying, that we are getting disconnected from the world, but I don't think it's going to stifle progress. I think what needs to happen is the development of more social norms to get people connecting together. And frankly, the best way I've seen that done is like what I do, join a Toastmasters club and learn the art of public speaking. Thank you very much.
That was 5 minutes, 10 seconds.
Thank you very much.
That's fine.
I'll reset it. Okay, Andy, 6 minutes.
Oh, you want me to go?
No, go ahead.
Okay. I thank Dr. Holland for giving us a lot of food for thought. I think the one thing that I think could have improved his speech was the advice we used to get from Mr. Barnes, my physics teacher when I was a junior in high school. And I never forget what he taught us. We'd be looking at something incomprehensible in a physics textbook, and he'd call on one of us. Miss Wilson, can you translate that for us into language that can be understood by your average gum-chewing American? What does that mean, your average gum-chewing American? You know, you when you're looking at something that's almost incomprehensible, information overload, you have to take a little time to explain it, think about it. I think what would have made tonight's presentation infinitely better would be to cut a quarter of the content out and spend time periodically explaining what it meant to us, rather than go right through with one piece after another, all kinds of heavy concepts and ideas there run together in a 45-minute speech where we didn't have time to digest it. I was taking notes the best I could. But at any rate, I consider myself an optimist. I just finished my 21st year. You have the time, Tim?
I'm not timing. It's 1:36.
Right? Okay. Well, I don't see it.
Oh.
Thanks. I'll keep track. I just finished my 21st year coaching as a volunteer science coach for Science Olympiad for 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. And the universal advice we give the 7th graders is, in order to solve any problem, you have to first correctly identify the problem and correctly identify the solutions. And if you can't get a wrap your head around what the problem is, then there's no hope in solving it. And Dr. Holland is absolutely correct. The human race is moving forward. We get as much change every 5 years, we get as much change as the previous 50. So our parents, people that were born back 1910, 1915, those people, in one generation, they went from riding horses to absorbing, watching television, watching somebody land on the moon. That's a huge cultural change for just one generation of humans. This, right now, we're living in a time in this country, Captain Kirk used to introduce each Star Trek program, James Kirk, he would say, our five-year mission is to explore new life and new civilizations, seek out new civilizations, to go where no man has gone before. And my brother and I, as we watch the daily news, we're thinking, we're in that territory where we're going where no one has gone before. No one in America, no one alive today, has ever seen a presidential race like this. And somebody had a hand up? I forgot to hand out, I've got a Xerox copy. There's a 5-page copy for anybody that wants it. It was printed yesterday off of Common Dreams. It's called, Did the Press Take Down Bernie Sanders? And the press absolutely force-fed us Hillary and suppressed the fact that Bernie was getting more votes than Hillary in many places around this country. They had to eliminate or suppress 3 million votes in Congress just to make it look like Hillary was the winner out in Congress. They still haven't counted 3 million votes out there because the younger generation waking up is realizing what Ted Aranda talks about here all the time is our present political system is not working. And one of the top 10, in 1997, one of the top 10 blacked out subjects that we reported on this blue flyer was that the reshaping of American society into two classes, rich and poor, the wealth transfer to the rich. There were people that had a handle on that 20, 25 years ago, and now we're seeing the evidence of it, where the, as Dr. Holland talked about, through 3, 4, 5 dozen people own as much wealth as half the planet. We haven't seen anything like this. Nobody alive has ever seen conditions like this, and we have to wake up and face the reality. And the first step is facing the reality in understandable terms of where we are and what's going on. And these books on the climate change, like this one from Professor Griffin, Unprecedented, talks about the climate problems, and the book is loaded with solutions. He has tremendous hope, as Harvey Wasserman wrote in 2007, a book called Solartopia. He said, look back from the year 2030. In 23 years, we could be running the entire human race with no coal, no oil, no gas, and no nukes if we just spent money constructively on the cheaper alternatives that were available in 2007. We're living in totally artificial times where a huge amount of money is being poured down the military rat hole in Afghanistan, Iraq, and 7 other countries to protect the profits of the oil companies, the billionaire predators whose only goal is 90-day corporate profits. How much profits can we make in the next 90 days? Forget about poisoning that river, forget about the rainforest, forget about all that kind of stuff. The first step in solving these problems is recognizing that these billionaires aren't just ordinary people with a little more money. They're predators, and we outnumber them 1,000 to 1. And this is what Bernie Sanders has been talking about all over the country. That's why the media has been blacking out the campaign of Bernie, where tens of thousands of people have been turning out, because he's been saying, it's not just me running for president, it's not one person. It's millions of people standing up and saying, we have to move forward. We have to do something about the conditions that have gotten so bad. So there is tremendous hope of things going on all over the world if you get outside the American media and use the internet to find out what's happening with beneficial things going all over the world. I'll try to give a summary of that with printed material that people can understand. Anybody beyond the age of 7th grade is going to be able to understand the handouts that we give out 4 weeks from tonight, summaries of what's happening around the world and what the solutions are. Okay, I thank you.
Next rebutter. you have an open mic, but go ahead. Okay, whenever you're ready.
Yes, I'm ready. I don't know if I'm adding or detracting, but I am commenting here. People, there are two kinds of words in language. There are words that are defined by other words, and then there are words that can't be defined. All right? They're experiential. Okay? So a word that can be defined by or can't be defined is something like red, hot, cold, sweet, sour. You know, things that you need a body to understand. If you look up a dictionary that says what's the definition of cold, it would be absence of heat, something that has a quality of cold. And the reason I bring this up now is because ever since people have been using words, we've been separated from the world. And so this has been going on for a very, very long time. The one thing that something else that I don't know is the perspective of youth versus age. I remember back in the 79-80, I looked at my folks and I said to myself, my God, they have gone through so much. Okay? They have gone from like horse and carriages, like somebody said earlier, born in 1910, 1920. They've gone from horse and carriages to, to automobiles, from crossing the ocean in 3 weeks on a steamer to crossing it in 6 hours on a jet plane, from the Great Depression through the Second World War, nuclear weapons, the Cold War, the countercultural revolution, the African American struggle for freedom, the feminist struggle for freedom, man on the moon, and I said to myself, my God, they've gone through so much, but I can't see the world changing much from here. And here we are in an entirely different world, and I suffer the same thing. It's like the kids, the millennials, are like, get used to it. I'm like, oh my God, this is such a change. So I don't know whether my reaction to what I see around me is because I'm an old fuddy-duddy now, or whether I have a valid point of view. I remember a thing when Edison created his first cylindrical, recording device. And people were writing in the papers that this is terrible. This is gonna separate people. Because before this, music was always live. Music was with a band, and a band was with people. And now you can listen to an orchestra in the privacy of your home. How isolating. This is the end of civilization as we know it. And, yeah, things change, but I just don't know whether my reaction to the world today is because of my age and my viewpoint, or if it's really legit. One thing I will say is that I've learned in my life is how much everything in the world is a Western point of view, especially if you live in a Western country. Okay? In the Olympics, all right, all of the events are like Greek heritage, Roman heritage, Western things. The Mongols have a sport where they have horses, they have something on the ground, they go fighting over it, it's not quite polo. You know, it's a very physical thing, they love the sport. It's not an Olympic sport, it can never be an Olympic sport. It's not, it's just, it doesn't appeal to us. Now I'm going to go on a little rant, okay? Starting in the 1700s, okay, and taking music as an example, all right?
First, we have the creation of violins, violas, bass fiddles, viola agapa, clarinets, all the instruments that make up an orchestra. And then we had the creation of the orchestra form, all right? And then we had people writing music. And then they wrote music, and they wrote it into an orchestral form. And then we had stages created. And then we went from, like, oh, it's not Bach, but we went from, like, simple things to very complex things, to, like, Beethoven, to Tchaikovsky, to Firebird, to what we, it's like in music, to ballet, to people dancing, to opera, okay? This is going on in music. Now let's take chemistry. In chemistry, we had the creation of the periodic table, the discovery and isolation of the elements in the periodic table, the creation of the periodic table, the discovery of chemistry, the creation of industrial chemistry, right? In the military. The military is such a clear example that there's no need to spell it out. In clothing, in manufacturing, we've gone from hand sewing to mills, to steam-powered mills, to printing machines now. What I'm trying to say is, if you were not in the Western world, if you were in India, or if you were in China, or if you were in Japan, and you were someone's wife, and you were watching what was going on in the Western world, you would look at your husband and say, what? What's wrong with you? Can't you do anything? Because we just took off. And it's in our nature to take off. We just do that. It's like change is good, right? Now, I brought up the question about Japan, because Japan has been isolated for hundreds of years before the U.S. government with Admiral Perry broke them out of their isolation. And since the 1990s, Japan has reverted to non-growth. And I think it's just the Japanese being Japanese. They were isolationists before, and they're just doing it again. Just like we are simply inventors. We just can't help it. The trouble is, it's very hard to compete with us because we have such a power of dreams, you know? Thank you. Great.
Go ahead, you want to take a few minutes? Go ahead.
Just less than a few minutes, actually.
Yeah, please, we got plenty of time right now, but you know, we might end early, but please go right ahead.
No, I will be brief. I just want to say, pull it down.
Yeah, just take your time.
Okay.
There you go.
I just wanted to say that I was a reactionary. In the late 80s, I had been doing office work for 15 years or so, and I did it in a very, you know, with primitive machines and liquid paper to get rid of mistakes, you know, and caressable bond paper that you could erase. And all of a sudden, I was encountering jobs where I had to be more tech savvy, and I resisted. I mean, not to talk about me, but I had temper tantrums. I was like, I am not going to become a computer. And it's like the internet, I am not too impressed. It's a lot of stuff on some system, and I just was not impressed. And now I'm like, just one moment, let me refer to my brain, you know. But anyway, I just wanted to add those jocular comments about myself. But thank you very much for your presentation.
Anybody else? We got an open mic, and please go ahead.
Yeah, I'll try something.
those of you that don't know me, I'm Doug. I've delivered a couple of topics, maybe three or four over the years here at the college. I'm going to kind of address tonight's topic a little bit from the idea of the experience that I have. I'm in mental health recovery. And I also want to point out, following this lady's comment about, you know, adapting to technology. It is a challenge, you know. Years and years ago, we had DOS, and then we had to adapt to Windows, and I was in accounting at the time, and I remember I had Lotus 1-2-3 worksheet that worked wonderfully off of DOS, and I built files, and all of a sudden, one day, I had to take a class in Windows and get used to Excel. And I tell you, it was hell during the conversion period, taking my DOS files and converting them to Windows, because they didn't match up exactly. It was, you know, you get used to doing one thing one way, then you have to adapt, and that was pretty hard. Some people really eat up this technology. I'm technically less inclined to, and sometimes we have to adopt, and sometimes we don't adopt, and that's one of the things I've encountered in mental health recovery is that, you know, we're always talking people in terms of progressing, but, you know, sometimes there are people that don't progress, they regress, or they don't change at all. They can't adapt to what's going on. I know a girl that cannot tell time. You know, it's a basic thing you learn in school, but her mental capacity is such that she couldn't tell the time, you know, looking at a regular watch. You know, the only way she could tell you the exact time was to see a digital watch. And to try and break herself of the habit, she went out and got a regular type of watch, you know, face dial, you know, with the numbers 1 through 12. And she's forcing herself to learn that. But at the same time, you know, there's things she can't do, math in her head and things like that. And a lot of people have limitations. Some people have trouble with memories. You know, you think, well, you see these actors on stage and they have whole scripts memorized that they can deliver on stage. And there's some people that just cannot, after they meet you, cannot remember what the heck your name was. And what's even worse is some people can get so mixed up that they don't even know what their own names are. I know such a person. She had competency, you know, she was a bookworm, and then one day she wakes up and she has all kinds of things happening in her life, and like her memory banks were erased. You know, she could type 100 words a minute, and recently she sat down at a keyboard, she couldn't find the letter A on it. So people, you know, do have struggles, and at the same time you have to adapt. And you know, we've seen a lot of movement. One thing I'm encouraged by, even though we really didn't talk about it, is the ability and all these problems of modern living and things that we have that people can adapt. And, you know, we see it in the movies. You know, you had total nuclear war. And then they always start the movie after the war has ended, you know, the society going forward. And they have, you know, given us visions about what the society could look like. So, you know, that is something unique to people, that despite problem situations that, you know, we encounter, or, you know, like the political movement today, you know, we got so used to establishment politics. Now suddenly Bernie Sanders comes along and excites 99% of the population, thinking that they have a right to determine the political atmosphere. And actually, this election may be the last time for establishment politics going forward. A lot of people realize that, you know, that there are too many people in power that are manipulating the political scene. And there's a lot of people at the bottom that should have more influence on what's going on. You know, we mentioned this thing about not having a budget. And actually, I think the governor doesn't perceive himself as a political leader. Actually, he perceives himself as a businessman. He's the CEO of Illinois.
And that's one of the problems. You know, Edgar was on TV the other day, and he said, you know, when I was in office, I made sure I had a budget. And he's trying to influence this governor, but he sees himself as the CEO, like I said, of Illinois. And CEOs are can real be real SOBs when they want to. So, you know, there's a lot of things, and I'm sure after he's out of office, and maybe even November, we may not see too many Republicans in office. And they'll let the Democrats run the state and take over for what this governor should be doing. Thank you.
All right. Go ahead. I'm sorry. But I didn't know he had another rebutter. All right. And 6 minutes.
I think the analysis tonight is correct. And that we have substituted humans for everything else. And we think we should dominate. And it's all about us. And there's extreme selfishness and subjectivity throughout the world, even worse than in the past, which was pretty bad then. But now it's more widespread. The last substitution was the electronic area. I somewhat disagree there. I heard the, I don't know his name, but I'm Charlie Rose, the head of the company that's bought Google or in charge of Google. He said, future's bright because now more people are reading, more kids are reading. Kids never read before, and now they're reading their smartphones now, which they never did any reading, or vast majority of them did. And I think he's right. They are reading something. It's garbage. It's trivia. At least it's reading. We could do something with that. But the odds aren't very good, you know. We're definitely in the minority here. But I'm not hopeless. I think we can accomplish something. I think what we need to do, and the question I asked was, how do we get men out of the, or humans, out of the center of the picture? Well, look away from ourselves, look away toward the world, look away toward nature, and, you know, look away toward meanings in general, but they have to be objective meanings, subjective meanings. You know, it's just pretty individual. It's not a belief that subjective is only relevant to the individual, too. And these days, it's gotten so bad that we think all opinions are totally up to the individual. And none of them can be proven, and that's just nonsense. It's sheer subjectivity. So my answer would be to look for more objectivity, more objectively meaningful things outside of ourselves. Yeah, look for them in relationships to others. Look for them in this building communities, starting out in our neighborhoods and working up there. To maybe being governor, anyone could do a better job. Sure. Establishing dialogue, talk with others, serious talk. You know, get out of ourselves. Find meaningful, fulfilling work. Try to interpret art. Explain it. Give reasons for it. Search for God. Give arguments for God, for and against. Don't be like so many people and say, well, I cannot prove physical things, man. But if I don't hurt anyone, if there is a God, I'll go to heaven. He'll let me go to heaven forever and be happy with my loved ones. And all my enemies will be in hell where they belong, burning forever, like Jesus told us they were. Muhammad, too. Maybe Moses. I'm not sure about him. But, you know, that's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. All those people are going to be disappointed. They didn't do too much. They didn't really take the God question seriously. They just thought their own, feeding their own souls, their own butts, in other words. and that's all they cared about. That's the problem. material things don't matter much, I don't think, somewhat. Of course, you need to survive, but what we really need is to look at ideas, objectively intangibles, beauty, goodness, truth. By the way, the next Southern's dialogue will be on truth. Not indeed truth. The only problem is the reason I didn't announce it to him was because I don't know where it's going to be. I can't find a spot where it's quiet and stuff like that. You know, so yeah, that's I have a bit of hope that we can, a lot of us can look at things more objectively and emphasize that there's something more than ourselves that matter. Thank you.
Before we have our Mr. Holland come up, I came across one of the nicest things about the internet is that you do get a chance to have art. I'd like to give this a quick listen here. Oops. Shoot. Ad came up. Of course not. You have to get these. Okay, here we go. I have to turn the volume up a little bit too. That's great. Anyway, we're going to skip it. Basically, it's a Gilligan's Island theme with getting trapped on the internet, but at this point, I'll try to play it some other time. Mr. Holland, technology, wonderful, just failed on me. Let's get up Mr. Holland up here and give him a hand to give our final remarks. And when you're done, just go ahead and gavel us out, sir.
Thank you for your thoughtful rebuttals. I heard a few criticisms, I heard a few bits of praise, and more importantly, I heard some sharing of perspective, which I think is interesting, that people take the opportunity to make a connection with a room full of people as opposed to arguing the case. I'm here to argue the case a little bit. So as I predicted, our first rebuttal was Tim, and he's in praise of technology and all the goodies that it delivers to us. He tried twice tonight to shove a screen in my face to show me something that he wanted to share, but right. That is precisely the wrong kind of sharing, in my view, because the screen separates people, even though you might be looking at the same thing. It's not part of shared cognition. It's not part of communication. It's a kind of gawking. He's also extremely concerned with what I would call our exterior conditions, our quality of life being extraneous to him, except in its material manifestations. My speech was really more about our interior conditions, our thought processes, our way of thinking, our consciousness, our willingness to substitute one thing for another thing as though they were equivalent, but are in fact not, and how as a result we have transitioned previously from different thought worlds and are now on the cusp of a new transition into a new thought world so long as life remains on the planet, which is not an assured thing. The introduction of various forms of electronic communication are not an unqualified good. Lots of writers in the 19th century complained, actually, in fact, the same way that we would complain about robocalls, that the introduction of information from outside the immediate environment was a kind of destruction of personal space and time, because the orientation to the world they had was one based on very long periods of time in very small local communities. So news from the outside world did penetrate, but it did so in time after it was digested and after it had become history, as opposed to learning over the telegraph, and I think this is something from the middle of the 18th century,
right.
Mark Twain or Henry Thoreau or one of those fellows complaining that he had just learned of Princess
somebody in the United Kingdom has now the whooping cough, which he found an intrusive piece of information. So the ability of information to come to you independent of time and independent of space in a deep contextualized flow has the effect of destroying time and space. And so we all live in a kind of nowhere and no when. Andy Anderson's criticism that I should have cut out a quarter of the speech and explained more simply to him is fully anticipatable, considering that his hobby that he announces every time he's up on the mic is to condense and simplify for people who don't have the time to consider things at length in depth. So I don't consider that a valid criticism, and I have never, ever agreed that the right thing to do up in front of any audience is to play down to them like they're seventh graders the way the evening news does. Bringing up Japan again, I take your points, I really do. And the one thing that I will reinforce about what you said is that I've heard predictions that because of the cultural coherence, their refusal to repudiate tradition and ancestral wisdom is a good indication that they may exit the modern world and go to a neo-feudal civilization in advance of any other civilized country on the face of the earth. However, that cannot be done with its current population or its current ecological resources. It just doesn't exist for them. So it will be a long transition, and it's going to require that they reduce their numbers considerably and that they forego many of what we consider modern conveniences and assumptions about how food and material wealth is distributed. In the meantime, their culture produces amazing facsimiles of American culture. So they are absorbed by what we do, especially things like pop music and reality television shows and game shows of all things, all creations of the American culture. Someone brought up software design as an example of progress, but I would submit that software design now is a product of designed obsolescence, so that you have to continue buying. Many of the pieces of software that we use and that we've been using for over 25 years now have already reached a level of maturity that requires no further refinement. We don't need new operating systems, we don't need new word processors, we don't need new spreadsheets or web browsers. We need stability and continuity. But yet, the makers and designers of these things continue to jam on us the need for progress and the need for upgrades and the need for some new bell and whistle to do something differently. Everybody who's used Microsoft Word remembers that they rearranged the Microsoft Word toolbar and then made it a ribbon, and then they made it a toolbar again, and they made it infinitely customizable, and now what they're trying to do is to turn it all into subscription services so that you no longer own and license the software, but that you subscribe to it as a web-based service and continue to pay. They want to continue their revenue streams. There's an ongoing debate, I think, in the world about what our proper roles should be as human beings. Are we here as units of productivity to create profit either for ourselves or for our bosses? Or are we here to live lives of hedonism and enjoyment? It's not an either-or proposition, but it's often phrased in terms of false dualism just like that. I don't have an answer to that, but I observed that a couple people commented something to that effect, and I would probably point to our own history when life was defined by struggle, and life was a veil of tears that we attempted to survive and overcome for as long as we could. The basic message of Aldous Huxley's Brave New World was the juxtaposition of the noble savage with the modern sated and drugged individual within society, within modern society. The modernist had no meaning in his life. The noble savage was willing to sacrifice everything to obtain it. The call for greater objectivity in the world is a false god. There is no objectivity that is not the structure of the brain or of cognition. We can adopt a pose of objectivity. We can attempt to place things outside of ourselves and view them as an object. However, that is simply not the way the brain works. Everything, in fact, is filtered through emotion, whether you believe it or not, whether you know it or not. That is the underlying structure of the brain.
There
is
a world out there, though. The
emotion, you said? Emotion, yes. There is a world out there, though.
I'm not saying there's not an outer reality. I'm saying that there's no objectivity. We are inherently subjective creatures.
I was saying we need to be more objective. I would never say we could be totally objective. We need to be more objective.
I'm saying it's a myth.
We'll have to have a debate.
He rules tonight.
Okay.
Since the subject of music was brought up, and I'm something of an expert on that, I will offer a little tidbit that I left out of the speech because I thought I would run long on time, and I guess I ran a little short. The development of music over the 2,000 years that music students study, from roughly the 11th century on to the 21st century, has the same accelerating, crescendoing urgency with respect to the need to innovate and change. So those first few hundred years, as things were coalescing, change was slow, and tradition demanded adherence to certain forms and structures. As time developed, the style periods in music became shorter and shorter, and then around 1915, or even earlier perhaps, just a little bit earlier, music collapsed on itself, at least the sort of art music that I've concerned myself with in life, and became its own worst enemy by chasing innovation, by chasing continued innovation, I should say. It had innovated for thousands of years already. So the substitute for musical expression became structural, and to a certain degree, philosophical. So I was going to bring up John Cage, who's regarded as a foundational American composer throughout the middle of the 20th century. He wrote a piece people are still debating about called 4 Minutes 33 Seconds that inverted the whole meaning of the art by having the performer not make any sound, and then the ambient sound and whatever the audience reaction was in the space became the musical experience. More recently, I learned about a piece of his called As Long As Possible, or just the initialisms, A-L-A-P, which is an organ piece that is intended to run for something like 1,200 years. So he actually wrote out a one-note melody, and every so often they changed the one note in this abandoned church space in France so that people can hear the next note in the tune. But because of the protracted nature of the tune, if it actually survives for 1,200 years before completion, what can you say about it other than that it's a stunt and that it calls into question what the real meaning and experience of music is. I think the same thing is going on in architecture. Architecture's principal features have been an expression of its time and functionality. How does the building, the structure, inhabit its space, and how does it function for the people who use it? These days, we have what I call stunt architecture, and Millennium Park, especially the Pritzker Pavilion, is a prime example where it's meant to be a band show for people to go experience musical concerts. However, when you get either on the lawn or even in the pavilion, you can't hear any natural sound emanating from the stage because its principal function, to focus the sound out toward the audience, failed by design. Instead, you get these bizarre structures that are gobsmacking, but the thing fails in its principal function, which is to be a venue for listening to music. Plus which, you can't overcome the sound of the city around it. One last thing and I'll be done. On the question of pessimism and optimism, which is also the question of hope versus despair, psychologists have suggested that there are inherent personal characteristics that define whether a person is a pessimist or optimist, and you can't really change it. Some people will always have hope and have optimism and think the best of developments no matter what. Other people will be despairing and ceaselessly hopeless, pessimist, because that's their nature as well. Ironically, it's the pessimists, according to psychologists, who hew closer in their appreciation of reality than do the optimists. And as you might guess, I'm a pessimist. Thank you very much. I think we're done tonight.
Devil. Right on the side there.
I call this meeting closed.
Thank you.
If you